trip to ensure that we get all the details associated with today's conference out. And then I will ask for a couple questions. All right, it's not going to be a free-for-all in the question piece. And most of you are used to how I conduct myself in these conferences, so I will call upon you and then determine whether I will answer your question. Okay? And today we're going to talk about a preliminary investigative report. So before I get into the narrative, if you're wondering what this is, it, I just brought it along as a prop today, and you will have access, and you will know how you will have access as we go through this. So good morning, I'm Sheriff Joe Lombardo of the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department. I realize it's been 3 months since you have received an update on the 1 October shooting. As you can imagine, this is a complex, protracted investigation, and we have done a lot of work trying to piece together what happened. Following this press conference today, we will be providing all of you and the public a preliminary report of the investigation. I will take a few questions, but I anticipate I will be directing you to the report, as it will probably answer most of your questions. To date, investigators have gone over nearly 2,000 leads and looked at 21,560 hours of video. As we knew going into this investigation, it would be labor intensive, and we were required an enormous amount of man hours, as we are still not done. Today's press conference is about the release of a preliminary investigative report prepared by the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Forced Investigation Team. Questions arose early on in this investigation as to why the homicide unit was not doing the whole investigation. Immediately upon the scene becoming static, our investigators separated the work taskings to ensure we would have the appropriate amount of resources assigned to each crime scene. Homicide was determined to be the primary in regards to Route 91 scene, and the FIT team was determined to be primary in regards to the rooms at the Mandalay Bay and Mr. Paddock. Both scenes included the assistance of the FBI. The release of this report is not standard practice in which LVMPD releases information regarding its criminal investigations. We would not, as a practice, release a preliminary investigative report, but this is a unique circumstance. Let me stress, this is a preliminary investigative report. In no way is this report comprehensive, nor does it encompass every facet of the investigation. It gives the reader cliff notes that are based on the facts of 1 October written by the detectives that investigated this shooting. The comprehensive, complete investigation will not be completed until sometime in the near future. Important piece on this, not all names associated with response to the report or the incident are included in this preliminary report. That was by design. It will be included, all names associated from my police department and every other public safety entity that responded and participated in different aspects of the event will be included in the comprehensive report. Due to the size and scope of this case and the community's desire to know information relating to the 1 October shooting, I am going against normal protocols and releasing this information now. We are talking about the largest mass shooting in the history of the United States. The men and the women of the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, and the other federal, state, and local enforcement officials that assisted in this investigation are to be commended. The contents of this report include, but are not limited to, the sources utilized in the investigation, an overview of the incident, the sequence of events beginning on September 17th, 2017, when Paddock checked into the Ogden, located in downtown Las Vegas, and ending when officers made entry into Paddock's rooms. The sequence in this report or the sequence timeline is based on numerous sources. Early on in this investigation, in the press conference, there was controversy about timestamps. That controversy will continue to take place. Timestamps are provided by the Mandalay Bay, by human sources, and various other sources to determine the exact timing associated with each officer's actions and the suspect's actions. 2159, that was provided previously. We are still utilizing that time more closely to 2200. And as you do your research, you would see what I'm talking about. A listing of 58 deceased victims. A listing of total injured will be provided in a completed report. For informational purposes today, we are aware of 422 individuals that suffered some form or fashion of injuries associated with gunfire. In total, we have determined there is 851 individuals injured directly related to the 1 October shooting. Also included will be a brief overview of Stephen Paddock. Also, a detailed account of the actions which took place on the 32nd floor of the Mandalay Bay. Descriptions of the Las Vegas Village venue and the 32nd floor of the Mandalay Bay. Items of evidentiary value recovered from various scenes. Preliminary findings from the investigation to include certain indicators of intent revealed by Stephen Paddock's actions leading up to October 1. Public venues and other locations researched by Paddock. And some scene photography or photographs. This report is not going to answer every question or even answer the biggest question as to why he did what he did. What this report will shed light on is the planning of the attack, the research that was done by Paddock in looking for public venues where crowds gathered, Paddock's movement in the days leading up to the attack, and based on witness interviews and evidence, how Paddock carried out the attack. You will see in the report Paddock's disturbing search history from his computers to include extensive search history of ballistics and SWAT tactics. You will see that we recovered numerous photographs of child pornography. And as to the missing hard drive that was mentioned in previous press conferences, we have yet to determine when the hard drive was removed. It could have been in close proximity to 1 October, or it could have been years prior. We are unable to locate it. As you will read, there was no suicide note, nor a manifesto left behind. No ideology or radicalization was discovered. We hope that the work continues to be done on this case and will eventually help paint a more complete psychological picture on why Paddock committed such evil. The results of the autopsy, the toxicology, and the pathology will be provided by the coroner's office. It's not a matter of public record. I realize there's litigation currently associated with the coroner's office reference this matter, but any information reference those three items will be provided by the coroner's office. I can tell you that the men and women of the FBI's Behavioral Analysis Unit are working tirelessly to provide answers as to why. But that is a long and detailed process. We're all going to have to be patient and let this investigation run its course. I know and believe there was only one suspect who killed 58 people and injured hundreds more. All the evidence recovered in this case supports that theory. There was one shooter in the 1 October massacre. There was only one person responsible, and that was Stephen Paddock. We do not anticipate charges being brought forward against Mary Lou Danley. As to any other people, the FBI has an ongoing case against an individual of federal interest. I will not be able to elaborate on that statement as because it's a pending investigation. Any further information reference that individual can be provided by the FBI. It is my hope this report will provide the media and the public an understanding of what occurred on 1 October. Before I close, I would like to address an issue a number of you have raised about changes to our police radio system. And specifically, if this will affect your ability to listen to our radio traffic. This change has been in the works for 2 years. 2 years. No relation to 1 October. It will enable our department to go on the open market to purchase end-user devices such as pack sets and radio. We are no longer having to rely on a single proprietary vendor. Subsequently, it will save the department money. It will also allow us to update our radios over the air via the internet versus manually manipulating them. It will also allow our undercover units to have encrypted channels for safety. The press will continue to have access to all our calls for service associated with the patrol division. At the conclusion of this press conference, a report will be made public going to the lbmpd.com website, and we will also send follow-up press release along with a link to this report. As a reminder, the mission of the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department is to make Las Vegas the safest community in America and the safest resort destination in the world. You have my word, and this is my goal, to focus as the sheriff of Clark County. We will learn from this incident and do everything in our power to prevent something like this from ever happening again. I'm happy to answer some questions. Yes, ma'am.
Are you guys still rolling out any type of terrorism connected with this?
Yes, ma'am.
On that note, do you have a message for Representative Scott Perry, who went on national television last night to say there was evidence, that he had evidence that ISIS may have been involved?
I'd like to see the evidence.
Sir, do you have any information to suggest that one of the bullets that was fired by one of your SWAT officers in the 32nd floor Mandalay Bay hotel room struck Stephen Paddock's body?
No.
Sheriff, in your last on-camera interview, you talked about some of the potential reasons why this happened. You said the report did not have why or a motive in this case, but you said that he was a narcissist, he was status-driven, and that that may have been a determining effect on what he did. Do you still believe that that is part of the reason why Stephen Paddock?
I'm comfortable with saying yes to your question. I put out in the public space that he had lost a significant amount of his monetary wealth in close proximity to 1 October, and that may have a driving factor associated with it.
Sure. Is that what you mean by
So, status, losing money, you think that is a potential motive in this case?
It could be. Like I said, the behavioral analysis unit of the FBI, who are the experts associated with the mindset of individuals of this type, are still in the throes of the investigation. And they anticipate an answer, not in the near future, but in the future.
To sort of follow what she said and then to what I was trying to get to, does his health play an issue, play a role in what you just addressed?
No, we're not aware of any health issues.
You mentioned something earlier that piqued our interest. Preliminary findings of intent. Can you elaborate on that for us, please?
No, I can't.
Sheriff, Metro's been criticized about the flow of information with the shooting. What would you say to critics about that?
Well, I don't understand why they would criticize us. If you look at experience with other police departments across the nation and are willing to disclose information associated to this type of investigation, I think we've been out front. My primary concern is not the media. My primary concern is the safety of the public. And I think we have been more than accommodating with the information associated with this.
Sure. Was there any that Mary Danley will not be charged in this case?
I'm sorry.
You mentioned that Paddock's girlfriend, Mary Danley, will not be charged in this case. Mm-hmm. But then mentioned that there is someone that is still being investigated. Can you give us any more information on?
No, I can't. And that's part of the recent litigation in the court where we attempted to remain, the affidavits associated with certain search warrants remain sealed, and that decision is going to be made by the court here shortly, but I cannot give you any more information.
So the attorney had mentioned that in the case, saying that in 60 days there could be a potential arrest or charges coming. Is that the case?
That's still the case.
And Sheriff, that's one individual they're talking about?
Yes.
Were there any warning signs, anything, whether it was at Mandalay Bay or any other locations, or someone he had a personal relationship with, any warning signs where someone could have spoken up to law enforcement?
No. And the answer to that question is contained in the report.
Sheriff, what kind of contemplation took place before you actually decided to release today's report?
That's a great question. For those of you that didn't hear what kind of contemplation took place prior to my decision to release this report, it was intensive. I've lost a lot of sleep over this. This is outside of the normal protocol. And the reason why I did it, and the reason why I directed the investigators to do it, is because of the public interest. It's no secret the size and gravity of this event, and I think it's a public service important for the public to feel calm associated with this event, and that we are doing everything we can to find a solution. It isn't directly related to the criticism that I've received or my department's received associated with it. I think it's record setting, it's a watershed event to release this report, but like I said in the early part of this, it is not going to be a matter of protocol. It will not continue into the future. It will be based on individual cases.
Was the FBI okay with you doing this? Did you talk to them? Did they say,
yes, I talked to the district attorney. I talked to the FBI. I talked to everybody that you would imagine in the law enforcement community and the prosecution community as to the soundness of my decision to do this, and they were all in agreement.
Sheriff, the FBI is not here today, nor is the district attorney.
By design. I asked him not to attend.
Okay.
Sure. Mary Lou Danley, I know a lot of people have questions about her. Is there, and just some confusion, is there any evidence that she's been on any surveillance at Mandalay Bay during this day or the days before?
That question is answered in the report.
Is the report that you guys are releasing different than the after-action review?
I'm sorry?
Is the report that you guys are releasing, is that different than an after-action review?
Yes, the after-action review is more encompassing to all. It's the public safety people that responded, and whether we were lacking resources, whether we had over-convergence, and what we can do better in the future. So, Rachel, I'm glad you asked that question, because it's three different issues. You have the preliminary report provided by the FIT investigators, and by the way, the two primary FIT investigators are here, the Sergeant Jerry McDonald to my right and Detective Trevor also. They are the authors of the report. So you have the preliminary investigation provided by FIT, you have the information that's going to come forward provided by Homicide, and the information that's going to come forward provided by the FBI and the ATF. That will be in the complete comprehensive report. I don't anticipate that comprehensive report to be completed until probably near the end of the calendar year, and then you have subsequently have the reports provided by the coroner, and then we have a report provided by the behavioral analysis unit. So they're all associated with disparate timelines, but this report here, I think, provides you the information that you need to know whether there's any other actors associated with this event and whether we are ever going to find out why.
Close is this report to what you believe will be the final?
Can you clarify the question?
This is a preliminary report, but there will be a final report. I think the FBI mentioned maybe in a year from November.
Yeah, similar to if you use Sandy Hook as an example, their report came out 4 years after the fact.
Almost five.
Is almost five, but this report we anticipate will come in close proximity to.
And so the preliminary report, you think, will be very close?
It'll be close, but voluminous. The comprehensive, complete report will be voluminous. And that'll include a lot more information, in particular, like crime scene photographs and things like that. And you get into specifics of individuals by name who are involved, witnesses and officers and everything else associated to their actions.
I have to ask last sure. question from you. Is the person that is being looked at, is it for aiding and abetting? Is it for...
I appreciate it and I understand your zest to get the information to those questions, but I cannot provide it because it's under federal grand jury disclosure rules.
Sure. Looking back, I guess my question is, why was the decision made for FIT to investigate the crime scene
in the hotel as opposed to homicide. You could argue that they do this every day and they could have perhaps processed the scene since that is what they do every day and they have such a great salt rate and so much experience with that. So my question is, why did FIT take over that part of the investigation?
Well, the answers were in your questions. We were, as I stated earlier, this is a very heavy, intensive, resource-driven investigation. We have multiple crime scenes, and we have limited resources in all those units. This is something we have never experienced before. But more importantly, the suspect was dead. It wasn't like it was a continued active investigation outside of any other players. The crime scene was static, and as Craig mentioned earlier, there was an officer involved discharge of his weapon, and that's what FIT is an expert at. They conduct all the investigations involving our officers involved shootings. They are very robust investigators, they're very competent investigators, and that's why the decision was made to do that, because the accidental discharge was in Mr. Paddock's room. And so the decision was made to bifurcate the investigative resources in order to conduct a complete investigation. And I'm very proud of what they were. They were very competent and they did a fantastic job. And that's why we did what we did.
Has the policy changed now? And would FIT still be the unit to investigate in a similar case like this?
Well, I don't know. Hopefully we never have a similar type case, but that decision will be made at the time.
So no policy changes yet?
No policy changes.
Sure. At Mandalay Bay at the hotel, it would seem to be one of the early trouble signs would have been the breaking of the windows on the 32nd floor. Do we know when those windows were broken?
I don't have the exact timeline on that, but I will refer you to the report.
Does the report also include what time Mandalay Bay contacted Metro?
Yes.
And one more question. Did you determine what made Stephen Paddock stop shooting?
No, and I have said it publicly, and I'll stand by it. I believe he believed the wolf was at the door. He believed that we were in close proximity of engaging him, and he decided to take his own life.
Did he have capabilities to continue the rampage, as in some guns working and ammo?
He had the capability, and you will see that as evident. All right, Ricardo, thank you. That was the last question with Ricardo. I appreciate everybody's time, and hopefully this will quell the zest for information. I know it will. There will be a continuance of the zest for information, and we will provide it as we seem appropriate. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.